I think wages are going to be high for a long time. I think we're going to hit historic levels of employment in this country.
I think there are good reasons to think that we'll come down very, very substantially on these inflation numbers.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tony Pasquarello. I'm a partner in the Global Markets Division of Goldman Sachs, and I'm pleased to be joined by two great thinkers in the business today who really sit at the epicenter of their respective crafts. Rick Rieder is the CIO of Global Fixed Income at BlackRock, and Jan Hatzius heads the Global Investment Research Division at GS and serves as the firm's chief economist. Gentlemen, a sincere thanks for being here today. There's so much going on in macro right now, and it's a remarkably interesting time, so there's no shortage of ground to cover. Jan, I want to start with you, and then we'll have Rick follow on with his take on the same topic. And so as we sit here today, core inflation in the U.S. is running at levels we haven't seen in 30 years, and the question of, is that transitory or is it not transitory, it's an enormous one, and it obviously has huge implications for markets and the economy more broadly. And so let's just level set your view. And I guess I'll lead the witness a touch when I say that on your estimates, this inflation surge, while it's currently huge, it won't stick forever. And in fact, by the end of next year, core inflation should be all the way back down towards 2%. Is that fair? And can you take us through your current thinking?
That is a fair summary of our view. And obviously we're far above that at the moment, 3.6% for core PCE inflation, more than 5% for headline CPI. But I also think we're going through an incredibly unusual environment where supply has been temporarily restricted in a number of ways and demand has been boosted, especially as far as goods are concerned, temporarily, but very significantly. And so I think in that environment, your bias should be that current data don't necessarily provide a great deal of guidance for where things are going to be a year from now. And I think there are good reasons to think that we'll come down very, very substantially on these inflation numbers. And I'd say on the supply side, a few, I think, really important disruptions that I think are not going to be there to nearly the same degree a year from now. The COVID impact on semiconductor output, especially in Asia, something that is probably diminishing and hopefully will continue to diminish. So that's the supply side. On the demand side, we've had a huge amount of support, obviously, and that's made a lot of sense from a policy perspective. And we'll get into some of these things a little bit more probably later. But because of the benefits and the enormous tax rebates that we saw, we've seen a very large increase in household disposable income, again, especially in the U.S., to some degree in other places too. But in the U.S., we've been above the pre-pandemic trend in terms of disposable income. And because service spending has been more restricted and people have been less willing to spend on services, they've had more money left over for goods. So goods demand has been particularly has been benefiting from that strength in income particularly. But again, I think all of these things are in the process of reversing or likely to reverse over time.
Thanks, Jan. Rick, same question, same topic. I guess my sense is you're a bit more open-minded to the idea that inflation might be a bit stickier for longer. So I'm really curious how you see things playing out perhaps a little bit differently than how Jan forecasts them.
So, I'll say a couple of things. I think the general trend, I totally agree with Jan. The way we model it up, we think core PC peaks around 3.5, maybe a little over that over the next few months, and then starts to revert back down. So, I'd say a lot of the headline that Jan described, we're in agreement. And by the way, we use his data in our models too. So it's not surprising we agree with a lot of that. Listen, I think there are a couple of things that are worth considering, though. There are, and I, quite frankly, we're always, we think about rates, it's hugely important to know what is that average number and to think about, gosh, where are and what's the interplay between real rates and not, and inflation to get to the nominal rate perspective. But I think there are a few things worth considering, and the dispersion underneath inflation, I just did a presentation talking about this, is pretty incredible. And I think there's some things that are going to be stickier. I think wages, for what Jan described, I think wages are going to be high for a long time. I think we're going to hit historic levels of employment in this country. And I don't think there's enough humans around for the jobs that are available, particularly in the skill sets. I mean, look at the Amazons, the Walmarts, the biotech hiring, the tech hiring for cloud, et cetera. It is extraordinary. And I, you know, look at, you know, restaurants' ability to bring in people. It's hard, you know, because there's so many jobs available. So I think wages are going to be sticky for a longer period of time. I also think, you know, when you think about the lack of CapEx expenditure in energy and commodities, et cetera, my sense is there's some stickiness there for a longer period of time. And then, you know, quite frankly, I mean, exactly as Jan described, I think the demand function in the U.S. is extraordinary and will continue. I have never seen the consumer in such good shape, delevered, long cash, prospects for employment and income being so high. And I think the companies are in this luxurious position. And by the way, I think there's a lot of price discovery going on at companies today. It's like, wow, you know, there's no degradation of demand. And maybe we can put through these prices. So you look at all these earnings reports that are coming out, all of them, but a lot of the earnings reports that are coming out is, you know, they're able to maintain margins despite their input costs elevating significantly. So anyway, you know, I've learned over the years that companies are in the business of trying to maximize ROE. And as long as you can keep putting it through and keep your margins sticky. So I think there's some stickiness to higher levels of inflation going forward. I think the most interesting thing is underneath the surface. And part of what I did in this presentation is I looked at, you know, look at healthcare and look at price appreciation in healthcare for whatever the last 20, 30 years. There's going to be some discoveries which we can talk about, but I still think that's durable in terms of increased prices. And then, you know, then we looked at things like autos. And you look at, you know, there's been some price increase in autos, but if you actually looked at it over a 20, 30 year period, it's actually not that, it's nothing relative to the consumption basket for individuals. So I actually think that it's a sector that can do well for a while because it's actually, as a part of your consumption basket, it's not that large. So from an investment point of view, I think the dispersion around inflation is pretty incredible. By the way, last night I was booking a flight from New York to Florida, and I literally saw United Airlines at $49, multiple $49 fares. And like, you know, we're gonna talk about inflation the next day, and it's like, wow, I can book this flight at $49. I paid up a little bit for a higher, better seat, but it's pretty extraordinary today about the dispersion underneath the surface. As Jan said, you know, services versus goods. You'd had no inflation in goods for 20 years, you know. Supply chain dynamics, some of which are easing, that have pressed it higher. And I, like Jan said, I do think you'll see some amelioration of that with, you know, with some, you know, longer term stickiness to and some parts of it for a period of time.
I think it's fair to say the past 18 months have been totally extraordinary. And so here I'm referring to a doubling of the Fed's balance sheet, an additional $5 or $6 trillion of fiscal spending, some bits of corporate bond QE, on and on. And so I think my question for each of you is, when we look back at the comprehensive U.S. policy response to COVID in, say, 10 years, what do you think could wind up being the regrets of policymakers, where maybe they went too far, they didn't go far enough, a given policy instrument was used too much versus too little? Rick, let's start with you on this one. And I think just judging from some of your recent work, perhaps you can share a little bit about your view that the U.S. should be able to successfully sustain the debt stack that's been built up over this period.
Yeah, you know, I think we're in a very unique point in time. And I think people underestimate the demographic condition we're in, and that as long as you keep interest rates down, as long as you are thoughtful about, and by the way, I think there's a natural reason why real rates stay historically low. And I use this example in the UK. I remember presenting at the Fed years ago and how the UK's pension scheme kept, you know, incented long-durated investing. And so what happened is their real rates have stayed low for a long period of time. I actually think now that pension funds are roughly fully funded in the U.S. and can defease their liability stream by buying long-durated fixed income-oriented assets, I actually think that real rates will stay down for a longer period of time. So anyway, I think the I think that is significant, and that because of that demographic, because of the growth of pensions and life insurance companies and demographic evolution, I do think that you can absorb, the system can handle a larger debt stack than we've ever seen before, as long as, you know, we're thoughtful about managing inflation, thoughtful about keeping those rates down. I think it's a unique point in time, and I'm not, you know, if you take, and I did this analysis, I looked at functionally the U.S. government relative to how I spent my whole career looking at companies, and I looked at, you know, if you look at interest coverage, or you look at debt to EBITDA, or you take your asset coverage, and you look at the U.S. and say, you know, and you put up all those metrics, and debt to GDP, you know, I think when people look at sovereigns, they say debt to GDP, if you approach 100%, that's really scary. You know, I'm not, if you're an emerging market country, totally get that. If you're the reserve currency in the world, I'm not sure I totally get that. And if you look at your interest coverage, your asset coverage, and taxation, et cetera, then I think you can actually run it. If you thought rates would spike 200 basis points higher, that becomes a debilitating dynamic. And then, you know, then you change that interest coverage dynamic. But I actually think the system is in a unique point in time. And I think there's real velocity to, you know, if you're using that fiscal stimulus in infrastructure and that areas that have velocity, permanent, durable velocity to it, then I actually think your tax, you know, what happens in terms of tax proceeds, and because of that velocity and because of that growth, that spending is and running that size debt load is not that scary, you know, relative to what, you know, where we were 20 years ago, et cetera.
Okay, Jan, and kind of similar question back to you. Curious, you know, 10 years from now, policymakers look back, regrets.
Yeah, I'm totally on the same page as with Rick on debt sustainability, and I don't have a lot of complaints, I would say. I think on monetary policy, they've done a great job, decisive on the way in, and they're being very deliberate on the way out. I'm also generally very positive on the fiscal policy response. I would say, especially in 2020, the CARES Act was very decisive. I think I would only have some small quibbles with the policy in 2021, where, you know, I think the enhanced unemployment benefits and the top-up payments were a great tool in 2020 and early 2021, with the benefit of hindsight. I think you would have said that maybe they should have ended somewhat earlier, not Labor Day, but maybe 3 to 6 months earlier to boost labor supply. And then number two, I think the $1.9 trillion American Rescue Plan Act was probably, you know, was larger than it needed to be. I think it did contribute to a temporary overheating of the goods sector. And so I think probably would have been better if it had been spread out over a longer period of time. But overall, I would give very high marks.
Okay, Rick, so let's get into the markets and translate, I think, some of what we just discussed into a markets framework. So you're responsible for nearly $2.5 trillion of assets. You command a huge business. You have a huge canvas. You have lots of arrows in your quiver in terms of markets and products. And so whether it's your short-term bucket or the medium trends, or the major secular trends, I think you kind of carve into those three pieces. Where do you have conviction now across that range?
So, I mean, I would say, you know, I always talk about this, like knowing who you are is really important, and sometimes I'm not really good at that. But, you know, I think being an investor means, you know, where do you think, you know, where do you think the puck is going over this sort of intermediate term? Listen, I think the equity market is going higher. I know I've been pretty adamant about that for a while. You know, I think the ability for companies to create ROE and book value accretion is extraordinary. And as I said, I think rates can move moderately higher, but I think this discount rate is going to stay down for a longer period of time. So I think equities are going high. I always find that when you look at credit assets, you know, once you've run out of things to buy and you say, gosh, you know what, it's all too high today, then you're out of steam. Boy, including today, looking at equities, there are a bunch of equities that trade with, our ROE is high, your multiple, you look at your free cash flow yield, your earnings yield. So anyway, I think, I'm not saying equities can't pull back a few percent, but I think we're going higher. And I think that, you know, when you look at asset allocation and think about what's going to drive, if I need to hit, let's just say a 7% return, and I think about my portfolio mix, you have to be erring on the side of the bottom part of the cap stack. And I think that will continue to drive your return. listen, I think rates can move moderately higher. And so, you know, where I think there's opportunity, I think U.S. equities, you know, still are very attractive. You know, there are parts of Europe, I think the banks are interesting in trying to discount the book. You know, not so much, you know, I think Japan is more of a tactical trade. And then, you know, in fixed income, I think you got to get yield into the portfolio and you got to be thoughtful about, you know, how much, you know, with some of these levels that aren't terribly, terribly cheap today. But boy, I think the securitization market, I think bespoke assets, you know, if you use your illiquidity buckets, you know, hold higher levels of cash, use your equity beta. Well, I think there's a lot of interesting things to do in you know, where you can be a mezz financer in commercial real estate, resi real estate, et cetera. There are parts of the credit market, actually, like European credit. You know, I think the technicals are given what the ECB is doing. I think European credit will continue to perform, particularly high yield. It's backed up a fair amount recently. So those are the primary areas. And we get into, I actually find growth equity to be the most exciting thing in the world today. And boy, I think, you know, look at how some endowments and foundations have done. I don't think that was just a one-year phenomenon. I actually think growth equity, the extent, you know, you can use that in your portfolios, take a little bit of that illiquidity bucket and say, gosh, I'm going to look at businesses that are scaling quickly. That to me is the most exciting thing in markets today.
Okay, so I want to skip ahead. And I guess if we take a quick step back, and talk about process and really your process. And so what I mean here is you guys ply slightly different trades, but in a similar sense, the world really only sees your conclusions and your track record. And of course, there's a tremendous amount of work and process that goes into reaching those conclusions. And so Jan, let's just start with you. Can you just kind of take us through how you get from A to B?
I think the easiest way to think about it is that the process is centered around the forecast, and the forecast is a living organism. It evolves via data releases that shape history and tell you about current conditions. It evolves via topical research that, you know, suggests where we need to change something. It indicates where you should focus analysis if you see, for example, that you're far away, obviously, from market pricing or consensus, then that's an area to really dig into. And because it, you know, it's sort of out there for everyone to see and people can see where it differs from what other people are saying, it triggers questions from clients that require research and which, again, often results in changes. So I think The forecast is really sort of the key part of it. Obviously, point forecasts aren't everything. It's important to have a sense of the alternative scenarios and the range of possible outcomes. And I would say we're doing more of that. We're looking more at, you know, probability distributions and probability weighted outcomes as opposed to just the baseline case. But the starting point for both the analysis and the communication with clients and with the wider world is the forecast.
Rick, similar question for you. What goes into a day? What's the process for trade construction, market outlook, and how do you get to your conclusions?
So, Tony, I'm pretty excited about, you know, something, the development, you know, we talked about data before. You know, we are in a crazy maniacal today about using, you know, quantitative analytics and marrying it to fundamental research. And I may be dead wrong, but I'm convinced that if you err on one side or the other, I think it's hard to create durable alpha. And so, you know, the idea of being able to use data assimilation in your process to think about, you know, when there's transitional moves in the economy or markets, et cetera, you know, the ability to study, I mean, the data that's available now to make you smarter about what companies are doing, et cetera, that's all, you know, public and through analytics and text mining, et cetera, is pretty incredibly powerful. But then I think marrying it to, you know, understanding the regime you're operating. I mean, we always start with, like, what is the big picture regime you're operating within? And if you get that regime right, and then, you know, if they use your analytics and your fundamental research, think about, okay, how do I express that efficiently? You know, and I do these monthly calls, which are you know, where I lock myself in a room for an entire weekend, which is socially enhancing like nobody's business. And but I, you know, I find, Tony, that, you know, there's a lot of, you know, following the news of the day, and, you know, probably like dollar yen just moved a tick, and what happened, and why did, what drove that? And I feel like I got to, you know, for a month, you know, we have our teams, you know, for 2 weeks, we start brainstorming around, you know, what is, you know, what does this mean? What does that mean? Why is this happening? And then literally I need like 2 days of quiet time and just to try and put it all together, not that I do it effectively, but try and put it all together and say, gosh, you know, now I understand why dollar yen is doing what it's doing, or I understand what the fundamental underpinnings of inflation are. And to me, that's been a really healthy process. And then, you know, I think technology is changing so quickly. And I think young people probably are better, are more versed and thoughtful about, you know, some of the tools you could use and some of the things that are developing around the market. So, you know, one of the things I've been a big believer in, you know, let a lot of your young people drive your thought process and drive your risk taking and, you know, give them some rope, let them be creative and entrepreneurial, and then try and bring that back and think about, you know, what's, you know, how are you managing all the portfolios relative to that? So there's a bunch of things that go into it. It's hard to articulate specifically how much weighs on different areas, but that is generally the idea around the process.
Rick, who are the other great investors in the marketplace today that you look up to and why?
Names?
Yes.
So here's where I get in trouble. I don't know what the distribution of this is. So it was nice you said other great investors. So I don't know about that. But I would say the two people that I think are extraordinary is Stan Druckenmiller, who just an interview with, and David Tepper. And I think there's a couple of things they do that are pretty unique. I mean, I was, you know, and maybe one of the things I've learned over the years is to be able to see the forest through the trees and think about, you know, there's news that comes across all day. And it's like news, that's a big deal. And I think those people have an incredible ability to separate the news from the noise and say, okay, that's a big deal. That's a secular evolution that I need to be attached to. And I'm in a position of portfolio and around that. And then I think, you know, I also think I just find it interesting when I talk to people that aren't taking risk and they tell me, oh, this is what's going to happen. But then you talk to some of the, you know, a couple of those people that are amazing investors, there's an incredible amount of humility. And usually start with, I don't know. And then you dig in and they do know, but, you know, they're willing to, you know, have some real humility around the positioning and say, you know what, this may not be the right timing for an expression. And I think they've done a pretty good job of that. I'd say there's one other, you know, person who hired me, which doesn't mean he necessarily is a smart person, but Bart McDade years ago, who is, I don't know if people know, I got to trade credit. I started trading credit. Anyway, taught me about, you know, we're in the business, taught me about research. And then we're not in the business of being right. We're in the business of generating return and making money. And that's a very, very different, I've learned over the years, it's a very, very different phenomena. You know, it's not about being right. It's when others think you're going to be right. And in trying to anticipate that and position relative to it. And Bart was pretty incredible. He taught me a lot about philosophy and mindset around generating or making money or generating returns. So big influence on how I think about things.
That's great. Jan, similar question, you know, perhaps maybe more with a historical bent, but who are the two or three great economists or policymakers who've earned your respect?
Well, I think you have to start with Keynes, who was really the first person to say something profound about business cycles and therefore the most relevant of all the, the pantheon of great economists to a forecaster. I love this quote from Fisher Black when he moved from MIT to Goldman Sachs. He said that markets look a lot less efficient from the banks of the Hudson than from the banks of the Charles. And I think most economists that move from academia to a forecasting or policy role would say that economies look a lot more Keynesian from the banks of the Hudson than from the banks of the Charles, at least in terms of the near-term ups and downs of the cycle. I'd also give a shout out to somebody much less well-known, Wynne Godley, who was a professor of economics at Cambridge, who died 7 or 8 years ago. And for many years, he emphasized the importance of the private sector financial balance, just the difference between total income and total spending of all households and businesses as an indicator of overall financial imbalances and susceptibility to financial friction and downturns. And I've personally found that extremely useful to look at, and not least, I would say, in the run-up to the 2008 crisis. And then on policymakers, you know, it's, I would say, Paul Volcker, Mario Draghi, and frankly, Jay Powell all deserve a huge amount of credit for doing the right thing at the right time and making a huge difference. I mean, that I think we've seen some really terrific sort of policy decisions at very, very pivotal moments, including over the last decade.
So, Rick, I know you don't have a lot of spare time given your job description, but if you could pick, you know, one must-read book for an up-and-coming money manager or a trader, what would it be?
I mean, I'll tell you right now, I'm reading a lot on about China and philosophy and culture, et cetera. And that, to me, you know, today, because the influence, I think, is hugely important. You know, I think there's, I don't know, there are a bunch of books over time, you know, because I'm so immersed in technology. And I mean, this is not necessarily trading or what have you, but I think some of these books recently around, or maybe not recently, last few years, Second Machine Age. There's a book called Capitalism Without Capital, but the growth of IP as an asset. Anyway, I think those are miraculous in terms of thinking through how the world is evolving, how commerce is evolving, how financial transmission is changing, et cetera. But those to me have been hugely impactful about thinking about where opportunity sets are today.
Jan, same question. What's one book you'd recommend for an aspiring economist?
Well, coming back to the Keynes theme, I think the three-volume biography by Robert Skidelsky, I think, is really terrific, not only about the economics, but also just about the time of the, you know, early part of the 20th century and then into World War II. I also think on a similar kind of period, but focusing on the central bankers of the 1920s and 1930s, Lords of Finance by Liaquat Ahmed, I think that's how you pronounce his name, I think was a terrific read. I think a lot of these sort of histories of economic thought and doctrine and policy making are very instructive, even from a modern perspective.
And then, Jan, let's just stick with you. What's one call from your career that you're most proud of? And then maybe one call, if you could have it back, you'd have it back.
Sure. So on the positive side, I would say the negative view on housing, consumption, growth, and, you know, ultimately the financial system in, you know, the run-up to the 2008 crisis, and I would say specifically the work on mortgage equity withdrawal and leverage losses, the impact of mortgage losses on lending capacity of banks and ultimately economic activity. I think on the negative side, our various quibbles with secular stagnation and the decline in neutral interest rates in the last cycle in the sort of 2010s. And I think a lot of the quibbles, even in retrospect, I think were right. A lot of these models don't really work very well. But I think, you know, to go back to something that Rick said earlier, we were missing the forest for the trees. And I think that was one reason why we overstayed our welcome on the hawkish side of the Fed call in the second half of 2018.
Rick, your greatest hit, and then maybe the not so much.
I will tell you the easier one is the not so much. I wanted to invest. I've been on the sales side for 17 years, 18, and I wanted to invest. And I was at Lehman for it, and I wanted to leave in 06 and start an investment firm. And you know, then when the situation things started bubbling in 08, and I left in the spring of 08 thinking this is the greatest opportunity ever for investing, particularly in credit. Anyway, it wasn't exactly the perfect timing to, I didn't think the world would come to an end. So that would definitely be the biggest miss. And I would say, you know, good stuff. I think we've, I've hired and worked with a lot of amazing people. And I think we've built, you know, a good franchise around our funds. We've gotten a lot of awards, medals, and quantitative awards for our funds. And I think, you know, putting the right people in the right place and, you know, collaborating, you know, has been good for us overall.
Okay. I think we should end on a high note. That was fantastic. Rick, Jan, this was a treat for me. I think this will be a great piece of content for clients of both of our firms. So thank you so much for taking that time.
Thanks, Tony. Thanks for inviting me. Thanks, John.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Rick.